unmute this. Hang on. There we go. Can you hear me? Hi, so excited to be here. You can see my hand, great. Really, really excited. As I said, I'm a self-proclaimed famous new media artist, and I'm hopeful today that I'm gonna get you all to believe that you're famous new media artists too, and that technology empowers us to call ourselves famous. Of course, we're all famous on the internet, and that's where certainly I'm famous too, I believe. And so, you know, technology makes us powerful. And we're all here today talking about technology, the latest technology, augmented reality, virtual reality. I want to take you on sort of a little bit of a journey on my perspective of augmented reality, what AR means to me, how I got to believe that I'm famous because of augmented reality. I've been working with it for, I don't know, like 15 years. You know, it didn't exist as a word, now it does, but I'm going to take us all the way back. Before I get there, you know, I need to feel powerful. So right off the bat, I'm going to use augmented reality to make me feel powerful. And so I've got a little setup here, that's why you're looking at my hand. And watch this, boom. Look at that, white cubes on my fingers. I know you're thinking, Jeremy, white cubes on your fingers. You know, 30 years of the military-industrial complex of technology, you know, on top of technology, just to get to a bunch of white cubes. However, I'm an artist. And as an artist in the art world, the white cube, let me tell you, white cubes are very powerful. They're the most powerful thing. In fact, you know, the museum is a white cube, but inside that white cube, if you haven't heard, there's an even more powerful white cube known as the plinth. And so what I have here on my fingers is actually the most powerful of white cubes, the plinth. And why is a plinth powerful? Because it can make any object you put on it seem important. Just like this stage makes me seem important, maybe. Or maybe not, I don't know. Anyway, so I'm going to use these plinths on my fingers to tell you a story about augmented reality. And it's not going to be a boring story, I hope. It's going to be a fun and exciting story brought to you as almost like, I mean, who needs nail polish, right? So if we go back, I want to take you all the way back. Actually, let me just show you how these work because they're kind of exciting. Let's see. I can have an exhibition here of this is a bunch of historic works. That's what a museum does, right? It puts work in context. I've got Duchamp and Brancusi and Jeff Koons. And of course, if you're not familiar with the stodgy art world, Nike. I know brands belong in galleries now too. And of course, I've been making work for years. And here's a few of the things that I've made over the years. Television face, augmented reality portraits. I made my wife pregnant recently, but in virtual reality. And actually, I can't take credit for this vase on the end. I don't know how it got in there. That's Ai Weiwei's vase. However, I've done a lot more than that. Believe me, I don't just have three things. I just ran it. The balance wasn't quite right. Anyway, I want to tell you. We can go through a sort of a history of exhibitions here. Actually, every exhibition can also have a title. And when I wiggle my fingers, the titles. There you go. Leap before you look. They remix. Becoming Jewish. That's a bit weird. Hang on. The end is here. Well, it's not really here. It's just beginning. Okay, so those are random. I have no idea what's going on. But a lot of what I'm going to talk to you today about is about real time. Things happening, improvised in the moment. And that's what AR and VR are really about. I'm going to tell you about it through the lens of AR. But here we go. We're going to go back and we're going to do our first exhibition. So the first exhibition takes place in the wild, well, let's give it a new title, All Men Become Sisters. Okay, in the wild 1960s. So in the 1960s, you know, artists were kind of frustrated. They were frustrated with the bourgeoisie. Probably many of us here are bourgeoisie, and I'm not, no offense. However, the bourgeoisie art world had become this place where, you know, art just existed for the market, where it was, you know, you're creating paintings just to sell. Still today, actually, 80% of the art market is paintings. But in the 1960s, people were violently angry about this, and they thought, you know, how can we fight back? They believed art belonged, you know, art, the spirit of making art and enjoying art is not really about the object, it's about the act itself. And these group of people, they called themselves Fluxus. And now you might know some of these people, actually. Yoko Ono, anyone familiar with that? John Lennon's actually better half, because she's far more famous in the long run. People like John Cage and Chris Burden and Nam June Paik, sort of maybe none of these other names mean anything to you, but I'm going to sort of put them in context for you. So, artwork at that time, you know, the idea was we could create it in real time. So this idea of happenings emerged. And you know, what you had suddenly was the artist, who this is me here in pink, and then the audience. I chose the Venus de Milo as the audience here on my finger. And for the first time ever, the idea of an artwork was created in real time. It just happened. Let me explain how it works, actually. Let me pick someone else in the audience. I was going to do Let's see. Let's take this handsome man here with a beard. Now look at him. He didn't know I was going to talk to him. He's turning slightly red. He's a charming young man, maybe so charming that afterward we're going to get in conversation. We're going to talk about how much we have in common and that he loves fingernail art as well. And now you see what's happening? Him and I are creating a connection. Something's happening in real time that's different than what happened in any other context. You couldn't record what just happened. We made an artwork where he got slightly embarrassed. I got a little bit nervous because I didn't know how he was going to react. I call that artwork Hot and Warm in the Forehead. It's maybe called Red Warm Forehead. And it's available to all of you, and we experience it in real time. That's a new idea, right? That real time, the idea that an artwork could be created in real time was a new idea. I've got a little piano here because one of the most famous pieces from that time was by a music, kind of a music artist or music guy named John Cage. A lot of people have heard about this piece, but he would do this thing, and I thought about doing it with you here today, but I didn't know if everyone would have the patience. But for 4 minutes and 33 seconds, he sets himself up at a piano, and he holds his arms in midair. He never plays a single note. Now, what happens in that moment is that instead of hearing, you know, what you had heard as the bourgeoisie for decades when you went to go see a piano recital, instead of hearing beautiful music, you became the music. The people in the audience, the sounds, the ambient noises, they all augmented. Let's just try it for a second here. Exactly, right? I just played you like a Stradivarius, if you will, or a Steinbeck. But basically, the audience becomes the instrument. The ambient noise that we are tuned out of suddenly is augmented. And that's sort of like, if you think about it, a really early form of augmented reality. Now, at the same time, real like people that we now kind of look back historically, I'm not ignoring them, like Ivan Sutherland, who is an early augmented reality pioneer. He was already working with putting screens in front of our eyes. And, you know, I could talk to you all about how augmented reality is about better maps and weather in front of our faces and heads-up displays. But what I really want to talk to you about is what I'm describing here. The idea that augmented reality is actually this inward-looking thing. It makes us inwardly powerful. It's more about identity, or it can be, at least. It's of equal value to think about how intrinsic it is or how inward-looking, how it can change the way we look at ourselves versus the outside world. So when I was a young student, an artist that made me kind of curious about this period and who I really looked up to is here on this little magazine, Chris Burden. Now, Chris Burden, what I just did with that forehead art, that was nothing, right? In real time, he was doing stuff that was really putting his body on the line, really putting himself in danger. While he was a student, he had himself shot, and that's what I've got pictured here. And I had always sort of built this up in my head to be, oh my God, like, can you imagine? That's the world's most amazing performance. I could never live up to that. And I was kind of a little bit of I felt like I could be macho. Obviously, I haven't really filled into my body over the years. But, you know, so Chris Burden, I'd built him up as this legend as a young man. And I thought, oh man, what it must have been like. And you could only ever find documentation of his work in kind of photos, but mostly just in text. And sometimes you might have heard of someone who saw a performance in the 60s. And I remember the most depressing moment of my life is when I found documentation of his works. He was famous for saying he would never allow his works to be documented. Now, why is this important, right? Why does it matter whether an artist wanted their work documented or not? Well, to the Fluxus artists or the performance artists that, you know, came out of Fluxus, it was important because the documentation could be bought or sold, right? It was the object thing, and it wasn't the thing itself. It wasn't warm, fuzzy forehead from a few moments ago. How on earth? We don't even know what that was like. We're going to talk about it for years to come, right? But we can't. We can't really ever be there again. That was a once-in-a-lifetime moment. So Chris Burden, when I saw the documentation of his work, which, again, I found it in a dusty library while I was a grad student. He opens this introduction to this documentation saying, I really don't want to show this, but people have been pleading with me. Please don't make me show this. And when I saw it, I have to say it was very, very disappointing because what it consists of is him standing. Now, it's film. Now, this is really important. It was shot on 16 or 8 millimeter film. I think it was on 8 because it was black and white, with non-synchronous sound. So the sound was separate from the film recording. What does that mean? Well, first of all, it means that when he shot this film, he didn't get to see what he captured. No one did. No one knew what was captured. In fact, it would have been sent off to a lab to get transferred to, you know, to be processed so that they could actually watch it on a projector. And that might have taken a couple weeks. Certainly today it would take that long because it's very difficult to do that outside of a big city. And then the sound would have been synced in separately. And then he might have sat down. So it might have been a couple weeks later, people sit down to see this thing that's nothing like the real thing. And that was fine, right? That was fine. However, there's sort of like, you know, people were still interested in this idea of getting close to capturing the thing that happened in real time. So let's fast forward to our next exhibition. So in the 19, let's call this capitalist realism, there we go. In the 1970s, or just before the 1970s, you know, a lot of technology people working on the best new gear, they come up, Sony breaks through with what at the time became the best-selling consumer electronics device in the history of mankind, humankind, womankind. And this is it right here. Now a video recorder that goes anywhere you go. Do you see that? There's a businessman, salaryman maybe, in a tree. He's got a little, there's little baby birds in a nest. I don't know if you can see that on these projectors, on this projection, but he's filming his little, he's videotaping actually, for the first time ever, little baby birds in a nest. Now, you might think, Jeremy, I do that all the time. At the end of the day, I finish work and I look for the baby birds, I get up in the tree, and we're used to doing that, right? We're all used to showing baby birds and cat videos and stuff online. But back then, the fact that this guy could get down from the tree, run into the living room, show his family the baby birds, look what I just saw. I just saw this. Put it on TV. That was revolutionary. So revolutionary, in fact, that an artist named Nam June Paik from Korea, who was one of the Fluxists in the 1960s, picked up this camera the day it came out at Macy's department store in New York. He bought the camera at checkout. He unwrapped it. A parade was going down the street outside. He recorded that parade going by and showed the work in a gallery in Soho later that night. He called it video art. Now, this might seem like marginal art history, but the fact that a person recorded something and showed it the same day was a revolution. That was a revolution, and it was shown in a gallery, and that was the first time something had been created in one day outside of a performance, like a documented work, and shown like that. First, no film had ever been created that way. Certainly, there were film experiments, and I won't get into the long history of film experiments, but that was a revolutionary act. And what was really innovative about this camera, which, by the way, was pretty crappy. So I've seen one. I've fiddled with it. I've talked to people that use them. They were magnetic reel-to-reel. So, like, there was magnetic tape that spun around and recorded the image. Maybe some of us are old enough to remember what it was like to have cassettes. It was like a cassette deck, but for video. It was black and white. The sound was pretty crappy. It was meant to be portable, so it had this, like, purse. See how he's carrying that little purse on the side? But it was pretty heavy, and often, if you bumped around, like, the tape would become unwound. So it really wasn't that great. It ended up in the corner of a lot of artist studios, a lot of people's homes, probably. Can I, show of hands, how many of you have a piece of technology that's sitting in the corner of your studio, apartment, loft? Right? Because it's usually overhyped. But what's really cool is what happens after the hype, you know, after you're let down. So after you get home and you've tried it out, by the way, I've had a VR headset in the corner for 6 months already, and you all will too. Don't worry, it's not the end of the world. We're gonna eventually find new uses for these things that aren't boring. So what happened was that the artists, it ended up in the corner, a few of them started saying, what am I gonna do with this thing? And what was really, the thing that really, that was the big innovation was that you could hook this TV up, a TV up to your camera, and look at your reflection in real time. So this is actually my professor when I was an undergrad here in Toronto, the late Colin Campbell, and a fantastic performance video artist. So what happens is, watching yourself on this TV is a new idea, in real time. So now it's not you recording the bird and then coming down to the living room, hey guys, look at this bird. I'm watching myself as I'm creating the work in real time. And you might think, oh my God, I do that all the time. I spend all morning in front of the mirror and then I do my selfie routine and all that. However, this was a brand new idea. Remember, to get your face on television prior to this date, you would have had to be on the news, famous, probably a politician, maybe super rich. But to get on TV was impossible. Now you're watching yourself on TV live. And what happened was the artist sort of like, you know, reflected on this, and it was this like new kind of electronic mirror, if you will. And they came up with a term for it, and they called it performance for the camera. Now, again, like I keep thinking these are subtle statements, but I think this is really, really important because for the first time, artists started saying, I'm not performing for an audience. That Fluxus artist who was performing for my bearded friend, by the way, what's your name? Shane, the wonderful, beautiful Shane. My wife's going to be jealous. Anyway, Shane was no longer relevant. It was the camera. I was performing for an electronic device. So me and the device couldn't create a warm and fuzzy the same way Shane and I did, right? We couldn't create that artwork. But we could create something else, a different kind of artwork. And they called that artwork performance for the camera. And a lot of video art was characterized by that. Now, what was it like? Why was it different? Well, these artists became very aware of how the device changed their image and their identity. And they embedded in that change the history of television, right? So a lot of them explored fame within that space because, hey, the history of television was the history of famous people, right? And so now I'm part of the history of famous people. And another thing happened, which is kind of interesting. And I want another show. I'm going to do the show of hands thing because I think it's fun. Has anyone ever been on a phone call and they hear a little bit of an echo of their own voice? Have you ever? Yeah? A little bit? So what happens when you're in that situation? I mean, I'll speak from my own experience because maybe everyone has had this experience. You sort of had this little moment where at first you're like, you're talking to someone about going to the movies. You're like, oh, can you hear that? I can hear a little bit of my voice. You're a little bit distracted. This happened to me the other day. And then they're like, no, come on, Jeremy, we're going to be late. We need to figure out this plan. Friends are waiting, da-da-da. And so what you start to do is you start to say, okay, I'll pretend like nothing is different, like this is the same thing. And I'll start to perform. What happens is you start to perform yourself. So you start to, like, act normal. As, you know, we've all acted normal when we're not really normal. And that act of acting normal is kind of a creative act, right? It's performing oneself. And so now we're all kind of performing for this camera on a regular basis. But at this point, this is the first time in history where people had that realization. Hey, I'm different when I'm on camera. I'm different when I hear a little echo of myself. And this is a visual echo. So history goes on. Actually, video art goes out of style for a little while. The 1980s roll on and into the 90s. Let's go to our next exhibition. And here we find ourselves, well, what's our show called here? Hang on, my hands. Come Shower or Shine, It Is Equally Blissful. Yes, of course it is. So what happens in the 1990s, 1980s, is experiments and technology progress leads to a new development in technology, which is basically the webcam. But the computer becomes the camera. It becomes possible to hook up the camera from the 1970s. It's possible now to hook it up to a computer. It was always a computer, but it was a really simple computer. This computer is a lot more advanced. It can do computer vision, it can do all kinds of things. In fact, there was a Canadian pioneer named David Rokeby, and he's still here in Toronto. He teaches at Ryerson in image arts. And I want to show you a little bit of his work. Actually, I had to install a little theater, a cinema under my hand here to show you that. Whoops, hang on, here we go. In the basement of this space, I have a little theater here. So I just want you to watch David for a second. Impactful, David. I was going to let that go in the background. But what you can see here is David performing for a camera, which is his computer. And what's really interesting when you watch the video is you can kind of tell he's not sure. He's kind of feeling it out. He's kind of like, oh, what would happen if I do this? Now, he wrote the software. I give full credit to him for that. But this is documentation of a performance, right? He wouldn't call this performance art. He wouldn't call it video art. He would say this is documentation, Jeremy, of my interaction with a computer. He's saying this is, you can't know what it was like to be there again, right? Remember what I talked about earlier, like, you know, you had to be there. This is an experience that David is having with the computer that we can't have, thank you. And that is really, really exciting. Now, David is so enamored with his machine, you know, with this thing he's created, that I'm never quite certain if he's fully in control. You know, that video artist from the 1970s, it was a pretty simple circuit. You could understand the whole stack of technology, all of history, in fact. But history here and the machine get a little bit more complicated. And I start to ask myself, is David in control or not? That's why I have a little image, of a little statuette of Stalin here. My Ukrainian grandparents would be very mad at me. But Marx had when I was in school, and I don't want to scare anyone off by mentioning the word Marx. I'm not necessarily a Marxist. I work at a software startup after all. But Marx wrote a book called Das Kapital, and in it he describes a really interesting concept, which I think probably a few of you have heard before, but I'm going to repeat it. So Marx had this, he distinguished between two kinds of machine, if you will, two kinds of technology. One was the tool, the thing that allows you to express yourself, that uses your motive force to create something new in the world. And the other that he described, far more dangerous, was something he called the machine. And he uses the analogy of sort of a young, I believe, I'm paraphrasing, but of a young, boy, he was forced into factory work and goes into the canning factory and has to pull a lever on a machine every single day, right, to make the canning machine work. And it wears away at his body and so on and so forth. But the main thing he gets across is that this person has no choice. They're part of a capitalist machine, of course, as well. But they have no choice whether or not they pull the lever, right? The only thing that machine can do is operate one way. Pull the lever, make the can come out, right? You can think of a lot of experiences in our lives that are kind of like this, where there are various machines around us at all times, and we have to ask ourselves, who's in control? Am I in control, or is the machine in control? This became like really interesting to me as a young student, and for when thinking about augmented reality, I think it's interesting to think about the user in this situation as well. Who's in control? So as a young artist, I considered sort of that world a little bit, and fast forward a few more years, and the internet and phones and video has really progressed to become like, something that we share on the internet. And again, now I'm thinking about David Rokeby and how much he understood about the machine. It was pretty complicated. He was trying to figure it out. The computer had become much more complicated by this time, especially, 2005, that's when YouTube launches and online video starts to emerge, even just in the last few years. But think about how complicated the camera we have now is, right? The webcam that we all kind of grew up with is a bit of a joke now, right? That webcam is now extended by the entire internet, which is extended by all of human history. And we place ourselves within that every day and say, hey, I belong here. Which is why, again, I think we're all famous, right? Because we're on the internet. And so I started making work in this frame and thinking of myself as this kind of artist that was trying to figure technology out and trying to figure out what it meant. And for me, augmented reality, really early on, it didn't exist as a word, was a way of kind of making that literal. Like literally sandwiching my body between the computer process and my performance, and then reflecting on that, becoming really self-aware was how I kind of made work. This is an artist actually doing similar stuff really early on named Petra Courtright. She's since become shown at the MoMA, and this is really famous work, even though it looks really simple. She's just sort of like scrolling through different effects on her webcam. We've all had a webcam, piece of webcam software that we bought, and there's different effects that you can just click through one at a time. And those effects are usually silly, right? And now we all have Snapchat, and Snapchat's altering our appearance, and we're sharing that with friends. Petra kind of fights back against that in this work by just having this sort of blasé look, right? Because what's the first thing you do usually when you have an interactive experience? What do people normally do? Hi, Mom. Look, I'm in a computer. You wave your hands. You smile. You make a funny face, right? So Petra, by just having not a funny face, is saying, hey, I'm in control here. This is a tool, not a machine. I'm going to show you a work of mine from that period on my little cinema. Hang on here. There were some other artists working, but I'm worried I'm going to run out of time. So I was making a bunch of work where I extend my body this way, but I'm going to show you this particular one called The Future of TV. I became really obsessed also with the way, if you think of the internet as a camera and the way we're interacting with it in real time today, I think it's especially relevant. Everything that's happening in real time in this moment is important. So I just got married in this video, and then I made a video in real time. This was now almost 10 years ago. I guess it was 2008, so not fully 10 years ago. No, it was 2010, so it was about 6 years ago. Hang on, let's just open up the cinema. And
Hi, of course, I'm famous new media artist Jeremy Bailey. Very excited to be here today to present on the future of television, to talk to you about the future of television, the topic of the day. I'm coming here to you live from, Maryland, Silver Spring, Maryland, where I just got married. I'm supposed to be on honeymoon, but of course, Omar, the curator, who was in attendance at the wedding, asked me, hey, Jeremy, you're a famous new media artist. Surely you could ignore your nuptials and your recent honeymoon and make a new work of art for me. Of course I can. And here I am doing it from my new wife's bedroom at her mother's house. And I'm wearing what I'm calling the future of television, which is really all about sharing. It's about fashion. It's about wearing what you like. As you can see, the trends are all around us. Watching television shouldn't really be about watching. It should be about showing and sharing, demonstrating what you like to other people. And so I've come up with this concept here, which is to literally wear television on your face and to control it with your face as well. I'm using facial recognition software, and right now I'm wearing three channels on my face, and I can control them using my emotion, my expression. So let me just walk you through how that works. Of course, this is all about sharing, and it's really all about yourself. It's about admiring oneself and being able to watch television at the same time, but it's also about showing other people what you like. In the future, as you're walking down the street in augmented reality, someone could immediately tell what you like and maybe get to know you a little bit better. Hey, I like America. As I just married an American, I like bunnies, maybe kittens, checkers. There you can see I'm changing the channels. And how do you change the channels? I'm changing them, like I said, with my emotions. And so to change my eyes, for instance, I just need, which are showing the American flag channel, I just need to smile and or grimace, just go like that. And you can see very quickly I can scan through several channels at once. There's the friends channel, there's the protest channel, there's my wife's mouth channel, which is, we're just trying to get that going. Producers are, there's TV channel, a pizza channel and a shake weight channel, a squares channel, a strobe channel. Why not? Hey, I like epilepsy, you can control the top here, the forehead and cheeks by looking surprised. I can just raise my eyebrows. There's a balloon blowing channel. Of course, the ladies of The View. We all love The View. Brad Pitt in a perfume commercial. There are still commercials. We still need to pay for this. And then of course, on the bottom, we thought two channels wasn't enough. We found a little bit more space to squeeze in a few channels there at the bottom. And now, look at that. I just have to, I the expression of shock was that changes my chin channel. And there you go. What a wonderful way to express oneself with the content that you love. So we're signing on new channels all the time. Of course, looking at the kitten channel and the epileptic seizure channel. Let's just change that. But I can just, through all sort of expressions, I can change, I can look at all, and everyone, you just didn't, okay, it's not always easy to communicate this way, of course, and watch and control. But I think it's really exciting, and I know I don't have very much time with you, but I just want to thank you. I'm famous new media artist Jeremy Bailey, and this is the future of television. Love you guys.
Okay.
Bye.
All right. Thank you. So, what's amazing to me about that is how much more like reality that goes every year. So I've been making that type of work now for about a decade, and I've made lots of different performances over the years where I'm augmented in different forms, sometimes actually in reality. That's me as a telepresent slave. I created all kinds of portraits, and I have a museum that follows you around the internet using ad retargeting. You can buy totes and stuff. I've filed patents for augmented reality for all of my performances, including breathing while presenting, so you guys can't do what I just did. I turned my wife into a unicorn, and I've done museums on my fingertips. I want to share this one last piece with you because I know I'm running out of time, and I'm supposed to leave a little bit of time for questions, or maybe I'll just run for the door. But this is a recent work, and I think it gets at the heart of what I'm trying to describe is the opportunity that we all have in terms of thinking about identity and thinking beyond maps, and I think maps and weather for our heads-up displays. So I'm gonna let this video run here. Turn the audio up.
Hello. Hi there, cutie. Just kidding. I'm famous new media artist Jeremy Bailey. So excited to be here at the South Bank Center to present new ideas to you, really. You know, the Web We Want Festival is on. That's why I'm here. I was invited to solve some of the internet's greatest problems. That's what I do. I'm a famous new media artist. So I go around the world. I walk around. I travel the world bringing creativity and technology to solve some of our biggest problems. Now, when I thought about the internet we want, I thought, well, what do I want? What do I need? I really need more people to pay attention to me, I decided. You know, I looked around. Everyone's on their devices. They're on their laptops, their phones, their tablets. They're on the internet. That's fantastic. The internet's very successful. I'm very happy for you, internet. Great job. But now, what about me? How do I get people to pay more attention to me? And I thought, well, of course, I need to bring the internet to me. And so, you know, what if people can have a conversation with me, interact with me, and get the information they need, listen to me speak while they consume the internet, while they get the data they need to run their businesses, to do the serious work that they're always doing. And so that's what you have here. You have this interface that it appears just below my eyes. So, yes, people look, I find they look a little bit below my eyes, but it's better than if they're looking over my shoulder, looking at their phone. And so that's what it is. It's an interface that exists in augmented reality. This is really the future. We're heading towards a screenless society. And why not put the screen on our bodies? All over our bodies. And right below the face is the best spot, I think. Because I can have a conversation with you. We can connect. And that's what the internet is about, connecting. We can have a conversation. And you can get the information you need. So here you're getting, you can see, you're getting you're getting world clocks, so now you can see what time it is in England or in Toronto, Canada, where I am right now. And look at that, real time. I'm getting the time in two cities at once, and having a fabulous conversation with Jeremy. Wonderful. And look, there's a simple way for us to interact with this interface. It's physical gestures. Of course it is. It's a physical interface. It's on my body. I just swipe up. There we go. And there we go. Now I have stocks. I'm paying attention to the stock market. Ooh la la. Apple is up. Google is down. We can have a conversation about that. Aren't we fabulous? Yes. Yes, we are. And so there's all kinds of information here. There's sports scores, of course. Here we have Arsenal versus Manchester United. Arsenal's winning. What an amazing, that's fabulous. What a miracle. This is the future. Anything's possible. And, We have the weather, of course. I always need to know what the weather is. This is the long-range forecast, well, two-day forecast. Everything is sort of in twos. It's more symmetrical, fits the body better. But look at this. It's so natural. It feels so intuitive. It just feels right. It's instantly familiar, this interface. You're paying attention to me, and you're getting the weather. What could be better than that? And you know, we have all of these different, video. Of course, look here, I'm able to advertise. I'm advertising for myself right now, but maybe I need a little extra revenue in my life. Maybe I'm not doing so well at work. Maybe while we're having a conversation, I'm advertising new denim to you, or an iPhone, new iPhone. Hey, get that device, whatever, but you're paying attention to me. And it's fabulous, but you know, maybe you just want to attract more attention, and so we have dogs. We just have playful dogs with sunglasses. That's going to get everyone gathering around. You need a crowd around you. You're saying something important about the world. You're philosophizing. Get some dogs with sunglasses up underneath your face, and suddenly people are paying attention. They're all gathering around. It's wonderful. And you know, of course, if you are really trying to get, you know, some real new ideas, to get people to pay attention, take you really seriously, you need some important men at your and so two busts of important men at my yes, absolutely, it's a great idea. And so we have Stalin and I can't remember this American guy here. Anyway, it makes me look smart to have them on my chest like this. Look, it's fabulous. Oh yes, denim, these shorts. Oh yes, spring 2015. It's all about short shorts and denim. Oh yes, you must get them. And now everyone is thinking, oh, Jeremy, he's so smart. He knows about all the trends, and we must listen to him more often. He's just such a wonderful human being. He's just so, oh, there's something magnetic about him. And normally I would wear a turtleneck, but it's just too hot today. And I find people, when I'm not wearing a shirt, the interface really shines. It becomes, it's more of a folk, you know, it's really like fashion. It's
You know, the data, the internet is fashion. Now, I love to dance. What could be more fashionable than that? And so we also, of course, have a streaming music. Now, I've got it set to be Beyonce all the time because that's just what I'm into. But, you know, you could dance to anything. And so, you know, to start your music playlist, you know, you swipe up and here we go. Now we're listening to music. And it's a visualizer. You know, look at this. Now, you and I, we could be talking, chatting, and then listening to our favorite songs. And you know, we're getting to know one another. We're connecting, just like the internet intended. And, oh, it's just fancy. I just love it. It feels natural. Maybe I'm touching myself. Maybe you're touching me. Maybe we're getting to know one another a little bit better. And we're dancing to our favorite music. It's wonderful. And look at this. Just so natural. I just find I just get everyone paying attention to me, and I feel so important. I feel so fabulous. I feel so special. Let's just dance for a little bit, though. Do that. Cigars on ice, cigars on ice. Feeling like an animal with these cameras all in my grill. Flashing lights, flashing lights. You got me pity, 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 baby. I want you. Anyway, you get the idea. It's just fabulous. And here we are back at the world clock. And, you know, we've lost track of time, haven't we? We've had a fabulous few minutes together. This is the future. It's coming soon. The screenless world. We're connecting with one another. We're getting the data we need to prosper, to buy more stocks, to track more time, to enjoy the weather. Anyway, it's all coming. Thanks so much for your time. Love you guys. Bye.
Okay, thank you, Jeremy. So, yeah, I guess I kind of want to close there. Maybe actually we'll put up a little exhibition of some work, some other things while I'm talking. Leonardo's David, my accelerator program, my wife again. Anyway, so I just want to close by saying, you know, I guess the reason I wanted to show these two works specifically is that there's a tremendous potential for self-expression for us to not just like tell, like do what they tell us to do. For us to go out there and kind of raise our middle finger, to get out there and just use these new technologies in the ways they weren't intended, in the ways that put our middle finger up at sort of consumer technology that are, I mean, this a little bit Marxist, that where we're using them as tools instead of machines. And one of the ways I do that is hopefully by making people laugh, by exploring my own identity, my sexuality, and making you slightly uncomfortable. It's gonna be really uncomfortable, so we better all be prepared to laugh and have fun with it. And welcome to the future. So I am here to answer your questions, and thanks so much. Oh, wait, there's an opening. We have lasers.
and single
legs. Thank you very much. I can answer some questions. Do I have like 2 minutes or so? Okay. Okay. Hey. Yeah. So FreshBooks, I'm still waiting. I have not yet, but I recently did a performance with Shopify integrated into it, and so I've started to integrate different APIs into the performances. And I think thinking about APIs as a camera is something that I'm really interested in right now. So. exactly. In that performance, I paint, and as I'm painting, you can buy whatever I'm painting in real time as I'm buying it. But as I'm painting it, and then I you can also like send me messages to have me move my body in different ways. Anyway, I'll do it another time. It's a lot of fun for sure. But yeah, FreshBooks has been really supportive as really kind of my benefit, like my I don't know, a subsidy in a lot of ways. And they support a four-day work week, so I spend 3 days doing this and working at NYU and stuff like that. Any other questions? Yeah.
You've been doing this for a while, you've seen AR
Yeah. Like, I mean, I think my belief is that AR will become a very self-expressive tool. And I can tell you, not a humble brag story, because I chose not to work there, but I talked to Snapchat about a year and a bit ago, and they were asking me to come join their team. And they gave me what I thought was, like, my artist statement as their mission. And it was, I was really, like, kind of impressed with that, but their belief is that everyone is missing this opportunity for self-expression. We kind of live in a techno-chauvinist world where we're told what to do by our machines, and their belief is that it should empower you to express yourself the way, you know, and communicate in new ways you never imagined. And that can be cheesy sometimes, but when it's just right, as we've seen, like, Snapchat kind of get a hold of certain technologies like that, it's like, it blows everything out of the water. We're no longer talking about, will people adopt this? It's like, no, it's fun, and it's changing the way we communicate. So, of course, they're going to, right? Yeah. I'll get you next. Oh, no, thank you. Yeah, so I think that that's the tension that I like to explore. One thing is I do a lot of live performance, and there is always the risk of, like, total failure. But I didn't go to improv classes, but I did go to performance art classes, and they teach you sort of to just live in that moment and, like, allow yourself to fail. But within there, you build, like, constraints that you can control, right? So for me, that's where the energy is. That's where it's really exciting to perform. A performance that's totally scripted to me is not interesting, but I am a puppeteer in that, like, I'm trying to exert my control over it, but I'm willing to sort of allow it all to fail. In fact, I've done this before and it's crashed, and it's fine, we just restart. It's okay, we go on. So I'm not really interested in, like, kind of whipping the technology so much as just, like, kind of coping with it and working alongside it and breaking it. Nam June Paik, who I mentioned being the first video artist, he had this great expression, which is, like, technology is garbage. Or I like to think of it recently more like a spool of fabric that you can unfurl, cut off what you need, and throw away the rest, right? But, like, you make it do what you want. Oh, hang on, there's this guy. Yeah. I'll get to you.
Working with augmented reality extensively, like you have you thought about the content filter bubble issue where people just seek out issues that reinforce their own beliefs, and that moving forward in an augmented reality world where
yeah.
You can sort of shape the world around you with a literal filter over
yeah.
Your world? Have you thought about that?
Yeah, I think there's, like, you know, a lot of people. There's a lot of opportunity for dystopia. There always is when any technology comes alive, for sure. Yeah. But yeah, hopefully I described this, like, we're inside of this circuit all the time. It's a mirror and it's self-reinforcing, right? And what's really important in any self-reinforcing kind of performance for the camera or circuit or whatever you want to call it is that you're aware of where you are injected in that space, right? That you can put your hand in front of the light or whatever. And so I think that it's going to be on all of us, you know, to find the agency within, not simply become content consumers. I think fake news on Facebook is a great example.
Right, yeah, I was sort of alluding to that.
Yeah, yeah. No, I read it loud and clear. I think we all are. And that can lead to very dangerous outcomes. That's why it's so important for us creators, I think, to get in there and, you know, fuck shit up, in my opinion. Like, you know, show the I would say, like, when I was a kid, I liked to take apart things as soon as I got them. But, like, taking apart the machine is sometimes more interesting than just, like, making it do its the thing
right.
It was intended
yeah.
to do. Yeah. Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks.
Since you have such a unique position with technology and you're kind of in this feedback loop, I was just wondering what your thoughts are on kind of the deep dream neural networking art coming out now where you're kind of giving a little bit of input and then the computer
yeah.
is doing
Yeah, thank you for asking me such important questions of the age. And I don't necessarily have the answer to that one. I can say I'm working with recurrent networks right now as an artist. And I've always believed that whenever one of these new scary technology comes along, it's my job to, like I said, get in there and just see what it feels like. and really see what it feels like. Like, what does it feel like to have like my creative agency robbed from me? And then I can maybe hopefully make something interesting, critical, funny with that. And so far I have like a little character that's available online and shown in galleries a few times that makes artworks on its own. It's like I uploaded myself into a neural network. And I'm doing a musical performance here in January with that sort of persona. So I'm creating like an AI persona, if that's my current answer to the problem. Like maybe I could like go on vacation and let AI handle the rest. But that's like wishful thinking, I think. Yeah, thanks. Great. I guess, is there like drinks or something now where we get to like hang out together?
Yeah, people can organize something and stuff, but yes, there's going
to
be...
I'm just making an announcement. All right, well, I hope to have a drink with a few of you. Thanks so much.